shaking cold. These hands are meant to hold.
Speak to me.
Welcome back to our discussion of acid-base balance and respiratory management. We're going to begin, I believe, at section four here by talking about mechanical ventilation. And this is kind of the component where we're going to take all this and kind of put it together. We're going to start by kind of talking about how different types of mechanical ventilation work, how it's different than regular normal inspiration-expiration in somebody who's breathing under normal physiology, and then we'll talk about applying all that to all the other science that we've talked about as far as acid-base balance, oxygenation, and all that good stuff. Okay, so when we talk about mechanical ventilation, before we actually jump into the actual machines and how they work, we really have to have a good foundation of what respiratory failure is all about. And remember that there's two different kinds of respiratory failure. The first type of respiratory failure that we can have is actually something called hypercarbic respiratory failure. And with hypercarbic respiratory failure, the whole respiratory failure syndrome centers on the fact that the patient can't effectively get rid of CO2. So we know that patients who have hypercarbic respiratory failure are also going to have respiratory acidosis, because respiratory acidosis is caused by what? The failure to remove CO2. Now remember, we said that CO2 movement is all about minute volume. We said that CO2 movement is completely regulated by how much you can move air in and out in a minute. And so when we talk about minute volume, we know that that's made up of tidal volume and rate. So when somebody has hypercarbic respiratory failure, their whole issue is the fact that they can't effectively move adequate amounts of air back and forth. They either cannot move it in a breath, enough air in a breath, or they don't have enough breaths a minute. So when we talk about treating hypercarbic respiratory failure, the whole focus obviously is then going to be on trying to improve that minute volume, whether it's trying to improve each individual tidal volume, each individual breath, or whether it's something as simple as just increasing the number of breaths in a minute. Now, remember again, hypercarbic respiratory failure, the hallmark of it, the way that we diagnose hypercarbic respiratory failure, is the presence of respiratory acidosis. Now, in contrast, the other type of respiratory failure that we can have is hypoxic respiratory failure. And hypoxic respiratory failure is because of an inability to effectively diffuse oxygen. So this goes back to all those principles that we talked about before, the whole thing about Graham's law and about Henry's law, about the diffusion of gas through fluid. Hypoxic respiratory failure is because the patient does not have the ability to effectively diffuse O2. And now, because of that, this is not a minute volume problem. And this is something that's really important that we understand when we're talking about managing respiratory failure. The first thing we have to know is whether or not it's hypoxic respiratory failure or hypercapnic respiratory failure. And that is so key, because the treatment of the two respiratory failures is very, very different. And when we go through school, one of the things that we're always taught, especially at that really basic BLS kind of level, is that when patients aren't breathing, the thing that we do is we ventilate them. We give them tidal volume. We give them rate. Well, if their oximetry sucks, then we kind of have this whole if a little bit is good, then more is better kind of attitude. And so when we are ventilating somebody, but their oxygenation is still poor, then what we want to do is we want to give them more minute volume. We want to give them more tidal volume and more rate. But that's not what fixes hypoxic respiratory failure. In fact, one of the basic tenets of mechanical ventilation that you have to understand is that hypoxic respiratory failure is treated by an increase in mean airway pressure, not by an increase in minute volume. I'll say that again so that it's very, very clear. We do not fix hypoxic respiratory failure with an increase in minute volume. We fix hypoxic respiratory failure with an increase in the patient's mean airway pressure. Now, when we talk about the way that we know somebody's got hypoxic respiratory failure, the hallmark of hypoxic respiratory failure is obviously going to be a drop in the patient's PaO2 and the patient's SaO2. The patient's going to demonstrate themselves as having hypoxic hypoxia. Now, when we look at hypoxic respiratory failure on a blood gas, it depends on where the patient's at as to what kind of blood gas they're going to have. We may see that the patient has respiratory acidosis, just like the patient who has hypercapnic respiratory failure. And when we do see that, when we have a patient who's got hypoxic respiratory failure with respiratory acidosis, that actually tells us that that patient has both types of respiratory failure. I'll say that again. If you've got a patient who's got hypoxic respiratory failure and has a respiratory acidosis, then that patient has both hypoxic respiratory failure and hypercapnic respiratory failure. Now, if it's an isolated hypoxic respiratory failure, if it's just hypoxic respiratory failure, then typically what we see is one of two other types of blood gases. Either we'll see that the patient will be in respiratory alkalosis, which we already talked about why that would occur, because if I'm trying and struggling to get enough oxygen on board, I'm going to blow off CO2, and if I'm blowing off CO2, that's going to put me into respiratory alkalosis. Or the other type of hypoxic respiratory failure blood gas that we see very commonly is actually a metabolic acidosis. And if we think about that, that makes sense, because if my patient's got hypoxic respiratory failure, I've got an oxygen supply problem. Therefore, the cells aren't going to get the oxygen they need. Therefore, they're going to convert to anaerobic metabolism. Therefore, they're going to make lactate. Lactate is an acid. Therefore, with lactic acidosis, we are going to get metabolic acidosis. So we can see where that definitely makes sense. Now, we said that the big thing about hypoxic respiratory failure is that it is not fixed with minute volume. When we talk about hypoxic respiratory failure, we said the way that we fix hypoxic respiratory failure is actually by increasing the mean airway pressure. So let's talk about that, what that means. When we talk about mean airway pressure, what we're talking about is the average amount of pressure in the airway. And if you look at the two curves beside me, if you look at the curve at the top, we'll say that that's a patient's intrinsic respiratory rate. You see that as the patient breathes, the pressure waveform goes up, there's a plateau as they inhale, and then finally as they exhale, the waveform goes down. Everything that is underneath that curve contributes to my mean airway pressure. Now, when we talk about ways to improve the mean airway pressure, there's several different things that we can do. The intrinsic thing that people want to do, like we talked about, is they want to make patients breathe faster. Well, if we breathe faster, what we do is we create more curves, and you can see in the graphic down below that there are more curves there. And with more curves, we may see that there's a slight increase in mean airway pressure. But the problem, though, is that when I increase the amount of breaths that I'm giving you, I'm not substantially increasing your mean airway pressure, but I am very substantially increasing your minute volume. Well, why do we care about that? Well, because when we increase the minute volume, what do we to CO2? We blow it off, right? So when I look at ways to improve your mean airway pressure, the way that we kind of tend to think of improving mean airway pressure by increasing respirations is actually not the treatment of choice. When you have a patient who's hypoxic, bagging that patient faster or increasing that patient's respiratory breaths, the number of breaths that they consume in a minute, is not the ideal way to improve their mean airway pressure, because when we do it that way, when we try to increase mean airway pressure with more breaths, we do that at the cost of blowing off more CO2. So let's look at another way that people commonly want to improve mean airway pressure. Another way that people want to improve mean airway pressure is they want to increase the tidal volume. They think, well, if a little bit of tidal volume is good, then a lot of tidal volume is even better. And if you look at our intrinsic breath rate in the top curve, and you compare that to the breaths in the bottom curve, you can see that when we increase the tidal volume, we do get much bigger breaths. And because we're getting much bigger breaths, we do have an increase in the mean airway pressure. But here's the problem. Almost always when patients have hypoxic respiratory failure, it's because of the fact that they've got pulmonary edema. And that's not 100% universal, but that's most commonly what causes hypoxic respiratory failure. And that pulmonary edema can be cardiogenic, like in the case of like somebody who's got CHF, or that hypoxic respiratory failure could be like in the case of ARDS, where it's a non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema. But regardless of the cause, in both cases, the alveoli are consumed by water. And so when I go and I increase the tidal volume, yes, I increase the mean airway pressure, but I do that at the cost of raising the peak inspiratory pressures and what we call the plateau pressures to a dangerous level. And when we talk about management of ventilator patients, one of the big things that we really push now is the whole idea of small tidal volumes, of what's called a lung protective strategy. When I go and I increase your tidal volume to try and make you oxygenate better, I'm undoing the whole safety that comes with the lung protective strategies. So increasing the tidal volume is also not a good way to increase the mean airway pressure. Now, having said that, if you go to pick up a patient or you assume care of a patient and that patient's on a tidal volume of like 3 cc's per kilo, then yes, obviously you need to go up on the tidal volume. But if the tidal volume is already within a therapeutic range, like if we're sitting in the, say, 6 to 8, 6 to 10 cc per kilo range and the patient is still hypoxic, going up on the tidal volume further is not a good way to increase the mean airway pressure. Okay. So what is a good way to increase the mean airway pressure? Well, remember we said that the mean airway pressure is made up of everything that's under the curve. And when we look at that first curve, the curve that's on the top there, the one that we've been using as our baseline all along, we see that everything under the curve is the mean airway pressure, and we see that there's two breaths there. We've got a fair amount of space underneath those curves, but we've said that this patient's still hypoxic, so we need to increase the mean airway pressure even more. We talked about the fact that increasing the rate is not a good choice, because when we increase the rate, we also increase how much CO2 we're getting rid of. We've talked about the fact that increasing the tidal volume is not a good rate, because that increases the peak inspiratory pressure and causes more trauma to the lungs. So where do we go? Well, the secret to improving the mean airway pressure really lies in the ability to add PEEP. When we add positive end expiratory pressure, remember we talked about it before, we said what PEEP is it's like sitting and watching a patient as they exhale through an ET tube when they're in the middle of their exhalation clamping the tube so that they can't breathe out any further. When you do that, you maintain some amount of pressure in the alveoli. You prevent them from completely deflating and collapsing. That is the key to successfully managing mean airway pressure. And so when we talk about hypoxic respiratory failure, when we talk about respiratory failure because of the fact we can't oxygenate, the mainstay of treatment for those patients is the addition of PEEP. Now, when we talk about PEEP, there's a lot of misunderstandings out there about PEEP, and there's a lot of, quite frankly, a lot of fear about PEEP that's unjustified. Here are some things that you need to keep in mind about PEEP. The first thing that you'll hear people say about PEEP is PEEP causes hypotension. Well, I have two arguments to that. The first argument is that if you put a patient on PEEP, what that does is that decreases their preload. And by decreasing their preload, that may make them hypotensive. If that happens, that is proof to you that that patient has an inadequate amount of preload. If you put a patient on PEEP and their blood pressure starts to fall, then obviously you need to give them fluid. The second thing that I would argue is, what is the whole purpose of your blood pressure? The whole reason why blood circulates in the body is to do what? It's to deliver oxygen, right? Well, if I've got a great blood pressure, but my oxygen saturation is in the toilet, is that really what we're trying to achieve? Is that really what's going to make the patient better? The whole reason why we provide the patient with circulating blood, or the reason why patients provide themselves with circulating blood, is to provide oxygenation. And so oxygenation has to be at the forefront of treatment. So PEEP is one of those things that is critical to understanding critical care and managing critically ill patients. So I'll say it again, when we have a patient who's hypoxic, well, a patient with hypoxic respiratory failure, the treatment is an increase in the mean airway pressure. And the mainstay of increasing the mean airway pressure is the addition of PEEP. Now, what about when PEEP's not enough? Well, sometimes we have patients that are so hypoxic that we go up on their PEEP and we go up on their PEEP and we still can't get them where we need to be. Well, in that case, then what we're left with is one last option to try and recruit this patient or save this patient. The last thing that we may have to do is we may have to actually invert or at minimum at least equalize the patient's inspiratory and expiratory cycle. Remember that a normal intrinsic respiratory cycle, as we're sitting here breathing normally, it will take one part of a respiratory cycle to inhale for every two parts to three parts to exhale. So for instance, in a respiratory cycle that lasts 3 seconds long, you can anticipate that 1 second will be spent inhaling, 2 seconds will be spent exhaling. That's normal intrinsic breathing. But when we have somebody who's in hypoxic respiratory failure refractory to PEEP, a lot of times what we have to do is we have to change that. We have to actually increase the amount of time that they spend inhaling. By increasing the amount of time that they spend inhaling, we allow more time for positive pressure. It's not at a higher level, it's not more breaths a minute, it's just longer breaths. So longer inspiration, shorter expiration. Now, the decision to go to an inverted IE ratio is not a benign one, so that's why it's our last choice for hypoxic respiratory failure. When the patient's got hypoxic respiratory failure, obviously the first thing we want to do is we want to go up on the PEEP. If that doesn't work, then one of the things that we will consider doing as we're doing other things is inverting the IE ratio. But when we do that with the very cognizant understanding that as I increase my inspiratory time and thus decrease my expiratory time, what's going to happen to my CO2? Well, we know that CO2 comes as a result of exhalation. So when I've increased my inspiratory time and thus shortened my expiratory time, my CO2 is going to start to climb. And in the ventilator literature, you'll hear that referred to as permissive hypercapnia. And usually what most of the authors out there that are experts on this will say is that hypercapnia is okay as long as we can keep the pH usually somewhere at least above 7.2. And it all goes back to your ABCs. It all goes back to your priorities. What's going to kill a patient quicker, being hypercapnic or being hypoxic? Obviously, the thing that's going to kill them quicker is being hypoxic. So when we talk about treatment of going back and solidifying all this, when we talk about hypercapnic respiratory failure, when we talk about the patient who's in respiratory failure because they cannot eliminate CO2, for that patient, we are going to focus on minute volume. For the hypercapnic respiratory failure patient, we are going to focus on increasing the tidal volume and increasing the rate. That's how we get rid of more CO2. In contrast, for the patient who's in hypoxic respiratory failure, the patient who's in respiratory failure because they cannot oxygenate well, for that patient, we are going to focus on improving the mean airway pressure. And remember, we said the first tenet of increasing the mean airway pressure was to put the patient on PEEP. And if that doesn't work, then one of the things that we can do is we can try to lengthen their inspiratory time at the cost of shortening their expiratory time. Now, when we're talking about hypoxic respiratory failure, the other thing that invariably always comes up is people ask, well, what about just increasing the oxygen? Well, there are pros and cons to just increasing the oxygen. Certainly in the emergency setting, when we're going to have a patient on a ventilator for a short period of time, like maybe a couple hours, going up on the FiO2 is not a bad thing. We can also do that. If you were to look at practice among physicians, what you'll typically find is that most emergency medicine physicians would tend to go up on the oxygen for patients who are in hypoxic respiratory failure. In contrast, most of your pulmonologists and intensivists would much rather go up on PEEP than go up on the FiO2. Well, why is that? Well, because one of the things that we now understand is that the longer a patient is on high levels of oxygen, the more toxic that oxygen becomes. As oxygen is broken down in the lungs, as it's oxidized, if we have high levels of oxygen, what happens is the lungs don't have the ability to completely oxidize that oxygen. They don't have the ability to completely break it down. And because we overwhelm the ability of the lungs to break down oxygen into a safe molecule, we actually have what are called oxygen-free radicals that start to collect in the lungs. These oxygen-free radicals can be very toxic, and these oxygen-free radicals, we actually think now, are actually some of the major things that cause things like ARDS. So For the short term, it's appropriate for hypoxic respiratory failure to go up on the FiO2, but definitely for the longer term, there's a preference for going down on the FiO2 as much as we can, and instead, if we need to augment the hypoxic respiratory patient, we go up on the PEEP. And kind of the magic number that most people shoot for is they try to shoot for an FiO2 of less than 0.5 or 50%. Most of your pulmonologists and your intensivists, that's kind of their big goal in life when they're treating hypoxic respiratory failure, is they want to get those patients weaned down to 50% or less as quickly as they can. And if they've got to go above 50%, then they would really prefer not to do that until they've already tried increasing the amount of PEEP or even inverting the IE ratio. Okay, so let's talk about the actual decision to go invasive. Let's talk about the decision to actually put a patient on mechanical ventilation. Now, remember that when we decide to put a patient on mechanical ventilation, this is not a benign decision. There are several pros to putting a patient on invasive ventilation, but there are also several cons. So let's look at the pros. Obviously, the biggest pro to intubating a patient and putting them on invasive mechanical ventilation is the fact that we get control of their airway and their breathing. We have the ability to control what their tidal volume is, what their rate is, what their inspiratory percentage of oxygen is, all that good stuff. The other pro that we get from intubating a patient is we get real-time assessment of their respiratory system. We can look at things like their peak inspiratory pressure and their plateau pressure to look at things like how tight their airways are, how much compliance there is in their lungs, so on and so forth. But there are also several cons to intubating a patient. There are several things that are negative about intubating patients. So let's talk about each one of those. The first big con is the fact that invasive ventilation is not intrinsic. You and I were not designed to be ventilated under positive pressure. Our respiratory system was designed to be negative pressure. It was designed so that when our diaphragm and our muscles do their workload, the intrathoracic pressure becomes negative, and that negative pressure allows air to come in. In contrast, when we put a patient on mechanical ventilation, we flip that around. We literally flip physiology on its head because we're now going to put a tube down a patient's throat, and instead of the patient getting negative respiratory effort, the patient is now going to get positive pressure because the ventilator is going to blow air down instead of air just being passively moved into the lungs as the chest increases in size like it does with intrinsic respiration. Now, another very real thing that we need to be very cognizant about every single time we intubate somebody is the potential for that patient to get ventilator-acquired pneumonia. As we speak, as this is recorded, ventilator-acquired pneumonia is the number one cause of iatrogenic death in the United States in hospitals. It is the number one cause of iatrogenic death. And the problem with ventilator-acquired pneumonia is that while we found several things to improve the chances of a patient not getting ventilator-acquired pneumonia, the reality is that there are still a large percent of patients that do get ventilator-acquired pneumonia, and many of our ventilator-acquired pneumonias are actually antibiotic resistant, so it's not even like it's an easy thing to get rid of if you get it. So we always need to have that in the back of our mind when we make the decision to intubate somebody. When I make that decision, I need to be thinking, yes, this is something that I need to do, even though there is the potential risk that this patient is going to get ventilator-acquired pneumonia. Now, another thing that we need to think about with mechanical ventilation is that oftentimes mechanical ventilation can actually decrease cardiac output, and that's because as we positively inflate the alveoli are wrapped in capillaries, and as those alveoli are positively inflated, that pushes up against those capillaries and it actually makes them smaller. Well, as those capillaries become smaller, then blood that's being pushed from the right heart to the left heart is now being pushed through smaller tubes. Obviously, because they're smaller tubes, it's going to take much more workload to move blood from right to left. What actually ends up happening is because of that change in pressure, we actually see that the right ventricle actually becomes distended. And as the right ventricle distends, it actually pushes the septum over into the left ventricle. And we call this intraventricular dependence. And this intraventricular dependence means that the left ventricle is now smaller than what it would be if the patient was breathing intrinsically. So we can have a decrease in cardiac output. Now, like for a nice healthy person who's going to surgery, when we take them and we put them on positive pressure in the OR to deliver anesthesia, is that going to be enough to be clinically significant? Probably not. But when we've got a patient who's already in cardiogenic shock or a patient who's already in septic shock, that movement of the ventricle and that further decrease in cardiac output can further compromise how well they're going to be able to do. So it's like everything else in medicine. It's a risk versus benefit. If the risk is the patient is so hypoxic that I cannot get them adequately oxygenated, or the patient is so hypercapnic I can't adequately get them ventilated with non-invasive ventilation, then I have no choice. I need to put the patient down and intubate them. But if we can manage those patients by a less invasive means, there's certainly a good argument to do so. Now, the other thing that there's lots and lots of literature about now and lots of discussion, one of the things that's really come to the forefront in critical care medicine is the potential for lung injury when patients are mechanically ventilated. And when we talk about ventilator trauma, there's three big things that you'll hear talked about. The first thing that you hear people talk about is the whole concept of barotrauma. Barotrauma was kind of the first thing to come along, and the whole idea was that when I take a patient and I hyperinflate their lungs, as I hyperinflate their lungs, those alveoli become so overdistended that as they become overdistended, they actually start to crack. And when they start to crack, air is allowed to seep into the interstitial space. In addition to that, it causes damage to the blood vessels around the alveoli. And what we can end up with is a phenomenon that's exactly the same thing as ARDS. In fact, a lot of people say that is ARDS. Now, barotrauma, the whole idea was that these damages were caused by an increase in pressure, that it wasn't anything that was causing this but just plain old too much pressure. Well, for years, that was a pretty strong argument, and then as we did more and more literature, we found that it's not necessarily because of too much pressure that this is happening, it's because of the fact that there's too much volume. So because there's too much volume, we came up with the term volutrauma. So barotrauma is lung damage that's caused because of too much pressure. Volutrauma is lung damage that's caused because of too much volume. In the real world, honestly, it probably doesn't freaking matter. What it boils down to is when we mechanically ventilate patients, if we do it inappropriately and we put too much air in their chest, whether you want to call it barotrauma or volutrauma or whatever kind of trauma, the reality is the same. If we're putting too much air into alveoli, they're going to overdistend, they're going to start to crack, we're going to have interstitial leaking of air, we're going to have damage to capillaries, and we're going to put the patient into ARDS if they're not already in it. Now, independent of the whole volutrauma, barotrauma thing, the other thing that we know happens very often with patients who are mechanically ventilated at high pressures is they do develop something called shear injury. And shear injury occurs when I have a patient who is essentially violently ventilated because they've got like fast inspiratory times or high pressures, and as those alveoli are constantly opening and closing, they're constantly rubbing against each other. And as the alveoli rub up against each other, obviously that causes trauma and that causes damage, and that damage can cause all the same symptoms and all the same issues that we would have that would lead us towards ARDS. Okay, now let's talk about the ventilators themselves for just a bit. When we talk about mechanical ventilation, the first thing that you have to understand about mechanical ventilation is what makes the ventilator stop blowing. And there's really two ways that we can ventilate a patient. The first way that we can ventilate a patient is with something called volume-targeted ventilation. With volume-targeted ventilation, all that means is that when I'm setting up my ventilator settings, I am giving the patient a prescribed tidal volume. So for instance, with volume-targeted ventilation, I may set my rate at 10 breaths a minute and my tidal volume at 700 cc's. So that means that every time that that patient gets one of those volume-targeted breaths, they're going to get a full-on 700 cc's. And there's a lot of advantages to volume-targeted ventilation. Probably the biggest advantage is that it's predictable. We know exactly what the patient's minute volume is going to be, at least what their minimum minute volume is going to be. We know that if I set 1200 cc's or 700 cc's or 200 cc's or whatever I set as my tidal volume, that's what the patient's going to get when they get a ventilator-controlled breath. Now, there's also a cost that comes with volume-targeted ventilation. In pure volume-targeted ventilation, where I'm just setting a tidal volume, the ventilator is going to deliver that volume come hell or high water. So if I've set pure volume targeted ventilation at 500 cc's, then every time that ventilator gives you a volume control breath, you're going to get 500 cc's, like it or not. And that can become a problem because the sicker people become, specifically the more their respiratory system starts to fail, and the more they transition into adult respiratory distress syndrome or acute respiratory distress syndrome, the more stiff their lungs become. And so as their lungs become stiff, the same tidal volume becomes much more damaging. So each breath really just increases the amount of damage that's being done to the lungs. We get that volume trauma and that barotrauma. So while volume-targeted ventilation has become kind of the tenet of critical care, and it's most of what we use in adult ventilation, there are some risks that come with it. And there are ways to mitigate those risks, and we'll talk about that. The second way that I can target a ventilator is I can target it based on pressure. So when I'm pressure ventilating somebody, instead of giving them a preset tidal volume, instead I'm giving them a preset pressure. So what I'm doing is instead of telling the ventilator, I want you to blow 700 cc's down this guy's throat, what I'm telling the ventilator is, I want you to blow air down this guy's throat until you hit a peak inspiratory pressure of X. So what controls the tidal volume, if you will, what controls how much air the lungs get in pressure-targeted ventilation is the peak inspiratory pressure. The peak inspiratory pressure is the point where the ventilator stops blowing. Now, there's one big advantage to pressure-targeted ventilation over volume-targeted ventilation, and that's actually the way the air is delivered. In most pressure-targeted ventilators, it actually is delivered with something called a decelerating flow. And what that means is that when I'm volume ventilating, the flow is going to be 100% until I hit the maximum tidal volume. So for instance, if I'm volume ventilating you and I set it at 700 cc's, that means that ventilator is going to go until it hits 700 cc's and then it's going to stop. So it's and it stops when it hits 700 cc's. In contrast, with pressure-targeted ventilation, the ventilator actually uses a decelerating waveform, and what that means is that as I get closer and closer to the PIP that the ventilator is designed to stop at, as I get closer and closer to that target, the flow actually starts to slow. So instead of getting like I do with volume-targeted ventilation, I get with pressure-targeted ventilation. So I get a slower and slower flow the closer and closer we get to the PIP. And this has really become valuable because we know that this decreases the whole issue of volume trauma and barotrauma. We also know that this helps with the whole concept of shear injury. So you're seeing a big resurgence in pressure-targeted ventilation. Now, let's talk about the pros and cons of pressure-targeted ventilation. Well, because of the waveform, because it's got that decelerating waveform, and because of the fact that you're limited by a peak inspiratory pressure, we don't have the concerns about barotrauma. We know that the ventilator, if we set an appropriate peak inspiratory pressure, that we're not going to get excessive pressures in the lungs. But having said that, when we're pressure ventilating, the one thing that we do have to be cognizant of is that as the lungs become more and more stiff, as it becomes harder and harder to ventilate, what we're going to see is that there's less and less tidal volume delivered because as it gets harder to blow, the ventilator is going to blow less. Now, so what do we do in the real world? In the real world, when we look at the literature and we look at what's really out there, and we can absolutely positively say this versus this, this is better or this is better, when it comes to the whole volume targeted versus pressure targeted argument, you have camps on both sides. And honestly, what it boils down to is that if we are volume targeting, we can do that safely if we are also monitoring the airway pressures and making sure that they're not excessive. So we're setting our peak inspiratory pressure alarms, we're making sure that we're not getting excessive pressures. Conversely, if we choose to pressure ventilate, that can also be done very safely if we are monitoring our exhaled tidal volumes to make sure that with each peak inspiratory breath, we're seeing that the patient is getting enough air. If you've got a patient who's got pressure-targeted ventilation and their compliance is starting to get worse and worse and worse, what we would expect to see is that their tidal volumes are going to get smaller and smaller and smaller. Well, that in and of itself could cause both hypoxic and hypercapnic respiratory failure. So we just need to watch to make sure that we have good exhaled tidal volumes, that we're still getting an adequate amount of volume. So to oversimplify, essentially what we could say is, if you're going to volume ventilate, you certainly need to be watching the pressures as well. If you're going to pressure ventilate, then you certainly need to be watching your exhaled tidal volumes as well to make sure the patient's getting an adequate minute volume. Okay, so let's talk about the difference between positive pressure ventilation and intrinsic respiration. So when we talk about respiration, and we talked about this before, we said that when we talk about respiration, the thing that has to happen for me to be able to take a breath is I've got to have enough work from my diaphragm and from my intercostal muscles. I've got to have enough work that I can create a negative intrathoracic pressure that's great enough that it can overcome the resistance that it would take to move air down into my chest. And we said that resistance was limited by three things: by conducting airways, by the alveoli, and by the thoracic compliance. Obviously, if the airways are small because you're bronchospastic, that's going to make the work of breathing harder. If our alveoli are full of water, or they're edematous because of CHF or ARDS, then obviously that's going to increase the resistance to getting air down into them. And obviously, if my thorax is not compliant because, let's say, I've got circumferential burns and I can't open my chest up with respiration, then that's also going to increase the resistance. Now remember, we said that when we talked about intrinsic respiration, on the exhalation side, we said exhalation was completely passive. A normal person, when they're normally breathing, does not have to work to get air out of their chest. You have to work to get air in, but exhalation is just relaxing. It's not something that takes work. Now let's compare this to when we put a patient on mechanical ventilation. Well, when we put a patient on mechanical ventilation, the first thing that we can take out of the equation is work. Because when we put a patient on a positive pressure ventilation, the lungs, the intercostals and the diaphragm aren't doing the work. The ventilator is doing the work. Now that has goods and bads. The first thing that's good about that is the fact that by taking the patient's workload over, I decrease oxygen demand that exists just from the working of the diaphragm. And a patient who's really critically ill and who's huffing and puffing, who's just fighting to breathe, one of those patients breathing like 40, 50 times a minute, just for those patients, they can use as much as 20% of the oxygen that they get in a minute just working their diaphragm. So for those patients, taking them and putting them under positive pressure ventilation decreases a lot of that oxygen demand off of the diaphragm. Now, the bad thing about that workload, though, is that if we just take that workload away, if we just put a patient on mechanical ventilation and we tune our ventilator in to where there's no reason for the patient to breathe, if we've set our vent setting so great that our CO2 and our pH are completely being managed by the vent, then the patient won't breathe at all. And if the patient doesn't breathe at all, then what ends up happening is very, very quickly, and when I say very quickly, there's literature to suggest even within a number of hours, those muscles start to atrophy. And the longer that those muscles are rested, the longer that the patient is not having to breathe on their own, the longer that the ventilator is doing all the work, the harder it is going to be to get the patient off of the ventilator. And that's why we end up spending huge amounts of time trying to liberate people off mechanical ventilation. Now, this is really important for us in the transport industry, especially because we have a really nasty habit across the country. One of the things that I have seen across the country is that in air medical transport especially, we tend to be really bad about paralyzing everybody. It's like you walk in the door, you see the patients on the ventilator, and you're like already reaching for the VEC or the ROC before you even know what's going on. And our thought process for this is, well, by taking this patient and paralyzing them, then I know that the patient is going to be still. I know the patient's going to be calm. I know that the tube is going to be protected. I know I've got control of their respirations. But the disadvantage to paralyzing people and keeping them paralyzed all the time is the ventilator's doing all the work. And if the ventilator's doing all the work, that means that the patient is not doing any work, which means the longer they're paralyzed, the longer and harder it's going to be later to get them off of the ventilator. And in the ICU, we've essentially abandoned this practice a long time ago, except for very specific subsets of patients. Now, don't get me wrong, there are still patients who do need neuromuscular blockade in order to facilitate mechanical ventilation. But your average Joe Blow respiratory failure, tidal volume of 600, rate of 12 kind of patient probably does not need to be ventilated. Does not need to be paralyzed. Where we really need to use paralytics is things like inverse ratio ventilation, patients who are truly bucking the ventilator, and we're going to talk about bucking here in just a little bit. We could use paralytics in patients who have increased intracranial pressure. We can use paralytics in patients that we want to decrease their metabolism, like let's say like patients like malignant hyperthermia or something like that. But just to get ventilator synchrony, paralytics are not the absolute answer. In fact, most of the time you can get very good ventilator synchrony if you do one of two things, or if you keep two basic premises in mind. The first premise is that your job is to set the ventilator to the patient, not the patient to the ventilator. The job of the ventilator is to meet the patient's demand, not make the patient meet the ventilator. So when your patient is quote-unquote bucking the ventilator, 9 out of 10 times when a patient is bucking a ventilator, it's because of the fact that the ventilator isn't set appropriately. It's not set to meet the patient's demand, the patient's not getting what they need, and therefore the patient is trying to overbreathe and the patient is trying to resist it. The first thing that you do to fix that is not paralyze the patient. The first thing you do to fix that is you make sure that your ventilator settings are going to meet their demand. And probably the most common reason why this occurs is because the patient isn't getting enough flow and they're trying to take spontaneous breaths. If the patient is taking spontaneous breaths, we need to make sure that they've got enough flow that they don't feel like they're trying to suck a breath through a straw. We want them to get plenty of flow so they can easily take a breath, so they can easily take a breath. The second thing to remember is that if your patient is resisting the ventilator, that is proof. Once you've assured the ventilator settings are where they're supposed to be, if the patient's still resisting, that is proof that your patient is not getting enough sedation and your patient is not getting enough pain control. Your patients who are on mechanical ventilation should always be getting sedation and always be getting pain control, and it should be given very, very liberally, especially in the emergency and the early critical care setting until we get the patient stabilized, unless there's some absolute contraindication, like for instance, the patient is profoundly hypotensive or something like that. So we've talked about the work side of it, and we've talked about how important it is to sync the ventilator to the patient. We don't want to minimize that workload completely. We don't want to take that away. We don't want to set the ventilator to where it's perfect, to where the patient doesn't do any work, because those muscles will start to atrophy. So we want patients to overbreathe the vent to some extent most of the time. Most of the time, we want our vent to do like a percentage of the work, but not all of the work. So for instance, if I want my patient to have a minute volume of 5 liters, most of the time, that doesn't mean that I want the ventilator to do 5 liters worth of work. I want the ventilator to do, say, 4 liters worth of work or something like that. So the patient still has to do some work, so the patient is still exercising their diaphragm and still exercising their intercostals. Okay, now let's look at the resistance piece of this. When we talk about the resistance, we said that there was 3 things that contributed to resistance. The first thing that contributes to resistance is the airway itself. And when a patient is mechanically ventilated, not only do we have the bronchioles, the bronchi, and the trachea, we've also got the ET tube and the ventilator circuit. And obviously, the smaller those things are, the more resistance there's going to be. The second thing that we have is the alveoli, and we said that the more those alveoli become engorged with fluid, or the more those alveoli become compressed because of interstitial edema, the more that it's going to be hard to inflate those alveoli with each breath. And finally, the third thing we said was thoracic compliance, which was how well can the chest wall itself move. Well, we have the ability to measure resistance when we're mechanically ventilating somebody. We have the ability to measure their resistance, and the way that we do that is with their airway pressure. And there's a couple of airway pressures that you really need to be intimately familiar with. The first airway pressure that you need to know about is something called the PIP or the PAP. The PIP is the peak inspiratory pressure. When you hear it called the PAP, that's the peak airway pressure. Those two terms are synonymous. The PIP and the PAP are the same thing. So the peak inspiratory pressure, the peak airway pressure, exact same thing. Now, the peak inspiratory pressure is going to be increased anytime there's resistance. So whether it's increase in the conducting airways, whether it's narrowing of the conducting airways, whether it's a smaller ET tube, whether it's a longer ventilator circuit, whether it's that the alveoli are not expanding well because of edema, whether it's the chest is not expanding well because it's too tight, all of those things are going to increase the peak inspiratory pressure. The second type of pressure that you need to know about is something called the plateau pressure. So let's talk about these two pressures and what they mean. So when we talked about the peak inspiratory pressure, the way that we measure the peak inspiratory pressure is there's basically a gauge or a digital readout on the ventilator, and what it's watching is with each breath, as the ventilator delivers a breath, in that breath, what is the highest point of pressure? Where is the very highest point of pressure? And usually the highest point of pressure in a normal healthy person is when their lungs are completely inflated. As the breath goes in, lungs stretch, 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 and when they're at their maximum stretch, when we have the maximum amount of tidal volume in, that's our peak inspiratory pressure. But not always. For instance, let's say we take a patient and we bronchoconstrict them. If we bronchoconstrict them, as we try to give that ventilator breath, instead of getting, what we're going to get is, there's a lot of resistance to getting down that airway, so that's going to increase our peak inspiratory pressure. In contrast, the way that the plateau pressure works is the plateau pressure is measured when the patient is completely inhaled, but there's no air movement. So basically, the easiest way to conceptualize the plateau pressure is imagine, again, I've got a little manometer sitting here on the end of my ET tube, and I inflate the patient. Now while their lungs are completely inflated, but before I let them exhale, basically I put a cap on the end of the lungs so they can't exhale, then I measure my plateau pressure. So what is the advantage of one over the other? Well, the peak inspiratory pressure, remember we said that any of the three things that are controlling resistance would increase the peak inspiratory pressure, whether it's an airway problem, whether it's an alveolar problem, or whether it's a compliance problem. When we talk about the plateau pressure, the advantage to the plateau pressure is it's measured when there's no air movement. It's measured when the lungs are fully inflated, but there's not any more movement of air into or out of the lungs. So what the plateau pressure is measuring is what pressure is in the alveoli and what the thoracic compliance is. So another way to say that is when I look at your plateau pressure, what I'm taking out of the mix, what separates your plateau pressure from your peak inspiratory pressure, is we take out airway resistance. So if you've got tight airways, your peak inspiratory pressure is going to go up, but your plateau pressure is not. So why do we care about this? Well, because the big thing that everybody talks about now in mechanical ventilation is barotrauma. Barotrauma, barotrauma, barotrauma. Too much pressure, too much pressure, too much pressure. Well, the thing is, we know that what damages the lungs is too much pressure in the alveoli. It's not about too much pressure with inhalation. It's not about too much pressure in the conducting airways. It's about too much pressure in the alveoli. That's what causes ARDS. Well, the advantage to the plateau pressure is it gives me the ability to take the airway out of the mix. And so I can look and I can say, what is the actual pressure down in the lungs? What is the pressure when they're inflated and there's not any movement of air? And when we talk about barotrauma, the big thing that everybody always talks about now is smaller tidal volumes, lower pressure, smaller tidal volumes, lower pressures, in that attempt to avoid all that lung damage and ARDS and the acute lung injury and all that good stuff. Well, what's the magic number for a peak inspiratory pressure? How much is too much? Well, there is no right answer because there's no way to tell when you're just looking at the peak airway pressures whether the patient's resistance is because of their airway or whether the resistance is because of the alveoli themselves. In contrast, when we look at the plateau pressure specifically tells us what the pressure is in the alveoli. And we do know what that magic number is. We know after multiple studies that when we take patients and we keep their plateau pressure less than 30 centimeters of water, I'll say that again because it's important, when we keep the patient's plateau pressure less than 30 centimeters of water, that dramatically increases the chances that the patient is not going to get ARDS. It increases the chances that the patient is not going to get acute lung injury or get valvulotrauma or barotrauma. So we can say with some amount of certainty, okay, if we can keep the plateau pressures less than 30, then that is a lung protective strategy for mechanical ventilation. That is a safer way to mechanically ventilate patients. Now, the last part of air movement that we talked about was exhalation. And remember we said that when we take a patient who's spontaneously breathing and we watch them breathe, exhalation is completely passive. It doesn't take any work in a normal, healthy person for them to exhale. Well, guess what? When we take you and we stick an ET tube down your throat, nothing changes. It's the exact same. When we talk about mechanical ventilation, remember that exhalation is still passive. You're like, well, okay, well, what's the importance of that? The reason that's so important is it helps to really make it clear why mechanical ventilation does not do a bunch to help people who have expiratory respiratory problems. So for instance, when we talk about people who have the ability to breathe in but don't have the ability to breathe out, like people with COPD, people with emphysema and bronchitis, some of our asthmatics, when I shove a big old ET tube down your throat and I put you on positive pressure ventilation, have I done anything to fix the problem? No, I haven't done anything to fix the problem. In fact, if I've done anything, I've just made your exhalation harder because instead of breathing out now into a nice big open mouth, as air comes out of your small trachea, it's still got to get up a small ET tube. So when we have patients with exhalation type respiratory failure problems, like bronchospastic type problems, the idea that intubation is going to make them better is a fallacy. Intubation does not, and mechanical ventilation does not, make exhalatory ventilatory failure better. Now, does that mean that it's not indicated for the patient who's in respiratory failure? No. Sometimes we have patients who are so bad, they've got so much air trapping, they've got so much exhaustion from exhaling out, that now they can't even exhale in. And those patients, those exacerbations of asthma, those exacerbations of COPD, in those patients, we have no choice but to intubate them. But having said that, the decision to intubate somebody who has got a bronchospastic disease or has emphysema or bronchitis should be a very cognizant decision. Because when you choose to intubate that patient, first off, you are not fixing the problem. What's going to fix the problem is medication. And we are also making the decision that this patient's inhalation is so bad that I've also got to take that over. So that should be a very cognizant decision. Okay, so let's go and let's talk about different types of ventilator control modes.